Well, hello, New Hope. We are on site only this week, and it is, of course, for safety reasons. It's not anybody's favorite way to get together, but I'm sure glad we can at least do this. And it is safe as long as you stay 6 feet from the screen, right? And wear your mask. I will mention this to you, that after being online only last Sunday, the 8th, the elders met the next day, and it was unanimously agreed upon to return to in-person worship. We need to be together is what was the consensus all through the room. And then you'll remember earlier this week, we announced that. And then about 48 hours after we had made that proclamation, the tide turned enough that we decided to have you stay home this week and next. And then after that, we're just going to have to reevaluate, but maybe longer. Who knows how things will be 2 weeks from now. And several things play into that. The governor, after we'd made our announcement, the governor dialed things back. The national and local hospitalization rates became the highest they have been the whole time of COVID-19. And if you look at the graphs, they're heading pretty much straight up. Our hospital's COVID unit is full, and staff are starting to get stretched there. And one of the reasons we originally dialed things back was so that we didn't overtax our healthcare system. Add to that the fact that we've got people in our fellowship who are positive right now, and some people who are awaiting tests. BCSC schools have gone to e-learning, and Jennings County was going to go back to in-person education, but infection rates in Jennings County are in the red, so they've backed off from that. Yesterday, I conducted a graveside service for a dear family whose papa, whose patriarch, died of COVID complications. And during the funeral, his 56-year-old son, who was completely healthy before his infection a couple of weeks ago, he listened to the service with his oxygen canister in front of him. He'd spent 10 days in the hospital on maximum oxygen, narrowly escaped ICU, and is now home, but he has a long way to go. And he tells me to tell you, you don't want this. Add in to all that the fact that we have a lot of vulnerable people in our congregation, and the fact that with this disease, you can't always identify the non-symptomatic carrier who might take it unknowingly. To the person who does get it and ends up with a bad case, you put all that together, and it just seems to scream, stay home and let's get by in other ways if we can. And I know this isn't ideal, but let's count it a blessing that we at least have the online option that we can do. And let's pray for a vaccine, which does seem to be on the horizon. Announcements thin out when we limit ourselves to online things, but there are still some matters to bring to your attention, like tomato soup. We're still collecting money, not actual cans of soup, but money for cans, for Love Chapel's Christmas Pantry program. The target is $650 for 1,300 cans, which will go into that many grocery packages for those people who are in need. As you might imagine, need has increased as of late. So let me ask you a question. Who would want somebody's grocery gift sack to come up short on tomato soup? Nobody would want that. So give. Send in your gift to the church, 1404 West 400 North, Columbus, Indiana, 47201, and just make sure you clearly mark that it is a gift for soup, and we need that money by December 1st. And here's the thing. I do not want to live with the shame of somebody pointing at me later in the year and saying, isn't he the pastor of the church that came up short on soup? Yeah. Love Chapel has some other jobs related to that project that you might want to help with. All of those jobs require masks and spacing, so they're pretty safe. And I'll send that out info out again in our prayer chain newsletter email. I'll also mention we have a quarterly congregational meeting that's supposed to come up this month. We've missed those this year because of COVID. And this one's pretty important because it's the meeting that sets us up for a new year, establishes church leaders, budget for 2021, and so on. So we need to do it in some form. We just aren't sure yet how we're going to do that. So just stay tuned and we'll let you know how we will conduct that meeting with you. So what follows is our the service, this morning's online service. Again, call this today a Mission Sunday. In the sermon slot, I've got that online interview with Tim Doggett, who has for a long time served one of the missions that we support, ACM International. Our call to worship and scripture readings are well-known passages with an outward emphasis. We've got some freshly pilfered music, too. And we end with a storybook for kids, the Christmas story. Because, as my wife says, it's never too soon to get ready for Christmas. Our tree went up this week. So let's... let me point you toward that future, a future we've lately been pretty sure of. So it'll be nice to think of Christmas and then beyond that. And then right after this, we've got a short health update from Brad York, our congregational COVID-19 advisor, with the word that right now is a very important time for you to take care of yourself. So please do that. But hang in there, because I promise you that COVID sounds like I get really Hoosier on that. I gotta fix that. COVID-19 will not beat New Hope 19. That's all I want to say. Enjoy.
Hey, how's it going? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Brad. How are you?
Good.
Good.
Are you able to see me as well? Let's see.
I don't see you yet. Now I see. Now I see you.
Great.
Hey, I didn't want to bother you very long, but I did want to check in and just get a Brad York report on how things are going. Just so everybody knows, this is Brad York, nurse practitioner with Southern Indiana Heart and Vascular, and Brad's has been our congregational COVID-19 advisor on how things are going and giving us advice on things we might think about as we go into this. So I suspect I'm looking into a not very good report, but go ahead and tell me what's going on.
I think things are going as expected. Essentially the surge that we were preparing for back in March and April is actually happening now. We were worried that as things got cooler, people congregated, more close quarters than during the summer. We were going to see a spike, and obviously it has. I looked earlier today, Indiana, I think the previous high I saw was like just above 5,000. Now it's 8,500.
Yeah.
So pretty big, obviously. As far as the hospital's concerned, as I was saying before, 22 was our highest, hospitalized patients that were COVID positive, and due to that primarily. We're in the 30s, reaching 40s now. It's a pretty significant strain on providers and nursing staff and other people that are involved in taking care of patients in the hospital with COVID, but we're going to double rooms on our COVID unit. We've opened up another unit for overflow, and that's full. So we have other options that, you know, we have a plan B and plan C. So we have options that we'll utilize if needed, but there's no slowing down just yet. So just what we know, wearing masks, social distancing when you can, trying to limit unnecessary, going out to places you could maybe avoid.
Right.
Just kind of thinking out of the box might be good when you can, just to help limit contact.
Yeah. And obviously that's the reason for our taking at least a couple weeks off. Although I look at the line, there's no sense of when the curve starts to cap, is there? You know what I mean?
I mean, really looking right now, no, not yet, but it will. We got some promising things in the future with Pfizer coming out with a vaccine. I think the FDA is going to go through like the emergency authorization use. They claim it to be 90% effective. So that's good, you know, and maybe that'll help. Hopefully that's not going to be the thing that'll bring us down. Hopefully it'll happen sooner than that, but because it will take time for even, you know, folks who do get it. It does take a little bit of time for it to reach its, effective use. But yeah.
Yeah. Well, if lockdown is, or some version of really keeping things tight, is what we're in for a while, it does help to know that there's a termination to it at some point with the vaccine. I think that is really encouraging news. You were on vacation this week, right?
I still am, actually. So to be frank with you, I'm only getting bits and pieces of what it's like right now in the hospital. I've been off all week. I did stop by the office earlier this week and talk with some of the guys who are working in the hospital this week. And, when we talk to them, there are definitely some concerns and worry in their eye, but, just do what we know helps and sure. We'll get through it. There will be an end. No doubt there will be an end. It's just a matter of safely getting to that, doing what we can to help.
Yeah. And people can still contact you if they have questions or
I think it's more important now than ever to emphasize that too, as things are picking up. Got questions? I'm definitely no expert by any stretch of the imagination. I have a little experience, obviously, and I'd be happy to share that and talk through things.
Yeah,
to get you to where you need to get to. Absolutely.
Good. Well, you're going to be really busy when you get back. So we'll let you get on with your few more hours of vacation with your family. And I know you were doing some home projects too. So best wishes on all
I'm
that.
Some lights out, actually. It's not even, Thanksgiving yet. And she's got me putting out Christmas lights.
Yeah. Make your wife happy. You've learned that already, right?
Right. Exactly.
Thanks, Brad.
No problem at all. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim good tidings of his salvation from day to day. Tell of his glory among the nations, his wonderful deeds among the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols. But the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy attire, tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Indeed, the world is firmly established. It will not be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad. Let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar in all its all it contains. Let the field exult in all that is in it. Let all the trees of the forest sing for joy. Before the Lord he is coming, for he is coming to judge the earth. And he will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples in his righteousness. Word of the Lord.
Do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
And I'll be reading Romans 10, 11 through 15. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses those who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on one that they have not believed in? And how can they believe in one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone be preached unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news.
This weekend has a big mission focus for New Hope. Yesterday, several of us from New Hope joined a worldwide online prayer meeting with TCM International, based in Vienna, Austria. And that, of course, is where our own Jacob and Kendra Jones serve. It was a fun event to be a part of. TCM is a mission with an educational interest. It prepares church leaders through graduate education for ministry in their homelands, primarily Eastern Europe and Eurasia, and now extended into Africa too. So it was good to join together with people around the world and pray for that ministry. And then today, our special guest is Tim Doggett. Tim and his wife, Cheryl, have served for many years with ACM International. So today it seems like we have dueling acronyms, TCMI and ACMI, in this spectacular cage match, except that they're working on the same team. I guess they're tag team partners, probably. But our original plan was to have Tim and Cheryl be with us in person and speak to us during the worship time. But the on-site doors closed at New Hope. But I got to spend some quality minutes online on Friday with Tim, and I share the recording of that with you. Hopefully you'll be encouraged by how we at New Hope are helping churches around the world. And conversely, I think, in this day and age especially, how they are teaching us and encouraging us.
Hello.
Hey, Tim, how are you?
I'm good.
Good.
How are you, John?
I'm good. I don't see you quite yet. Tell them how I see you.
I'm a little new to this.
Yeah, I don't do it as much as a lot of people do, so I'm sure there will be a fail or two here, but that's okay.
Okay. Sounds good.
Yeah, it's good seeing you. I'm sorry we have to meet like this, but it's probably for the best given what's happening around here. So.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, at least
it's all over the world.
Yeah, at least we have this.
That's right.
Just so everybody knows, Tim and Cheryl are with ACM International. And what is that? Does it still stand for what it used to stand for?
It stands for the Alliance of Christian Missions.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Alliance of Christian.
But the official name is ACM International. So.
Okay. We'll go with that.
Yeah.
And if all my technological skills come through, there will be a little logo and website pop up right now so people can see that. And
oh, cool.
Check into it at some point.
Yeah.
It's good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you.
I should tell everybody I like Tim because he's an airplane guy, right? I don't fly, but I'm very fascinated by airplanes. And so I always like to hear your stories.
Yeah.
So that's good.
Yeah.
Well, I think we've got, let's do about 25 minutes here.
Okay.
I'll do one more warning. There's a chance the Schwann man will show up, and he's bringing my holiday supply of peppermint stick ice cream. So if the doorbell rings, I'm going to pop up and go get it, and you can either keep talking or I'll edit out the blank space later, okay?
All right. All right. I'll just wait for you.
Yeah.
That'll work. I wish I was there to share it with you.
Yeah, I'd happily do it. I would. I don't know how generous I am early in the season with the scoops, but I would definitely share it with you.
All right. Sounds good.
So, just tell me what you guys are up to right now, like recent past, what's been happening.
We're in a pretty big transition. We've been in a partnership that had us living in Africa, in the northwestern part of Kenya. And I was sharing my time between ACM and Samaritan's Purse, working as a pilot and an administrator. Actually doing mostly training. And we just transitioned away from a more full-time status with Samaritan's Purse, and I'm back more full-time with ACM International. Now Cheryl's position hasn't changed at all, and I've been sharing my time. We've both been working with ACM some. Cheryl still works as the office manager, and I'll be working as the member development director. So we're transitioning back away from Africa and going to be back here based in the States, working with ACM more full-time. So yeah, if you want to know a little bit more about those positions, I'd be glad to share that as well.
Yeah, I would. We've got time, so go ahead.
Okay, sure. Yeah, so Cheryl's main role is to kind of keep the operation of ACM International going. She's the office manager. She helps keep us legal with the government, make sure all the reports are getting done, make sure our financial accountability systems are functioning. She oversees any staff that we have, and right now the main staff that we have is a financial accountant. And then she does event planning, logistics, like the ICOM that's coming up. She has been kind of responsible for taking care of that. And anything else that our new executive director wants her to do, that's what she does. And she's been actually pretty busy over the last couple of years, because we've been through two fairly major leadership transitions, and so she's been kind of the constant, keeping things running as those transitions have taken place. But things are kind of stabilizing now, and she'll continue to do that. On the member development side, it's a bit of a story, but we actually see this as a role that Cheryl and I will share. But basically, we will be coming alongside of new missionaries doing their training. Initially, there's two different orientations that new ACM International missionaries go through, and we'll be conducting those. And then we also envision follow-up from those trainings. A lot of times the training doesn't stick when somebody hasn't been overseas before, and it's not till they get there that they start to have those little files that they can put their information in. And so we envision doing some follow-up when new missionaries get on the field. Also be working with the teams that are over there, doing team building exercises and trainings for them. And pretty much supporting them in any way that we can. Maybe do a little bit of coaching, debriefing as necessary. It's actually a work in progress, so we don't know exactly what it's going to look like, but those are the ideas that have been thrown around so far from our executive director and our discussions with him. But
yeah,
that's what we're moving into. So we're transitioning again.
You have big plans a vision for that, or where it ends up in the future, or?
The member development?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the main goal is to keep healthy missionaries out on the field that are effective planting the gospel, the seeds of the gospel, and planting churches. So that's the big goal. Healthy teams and healthy people that make up those teams, serving the Lord and advancing the kingdom.
Cool. Good.
Yeah.
Where you got? Where are you right now? And where is this? Where you will is where you are now? Where you will be?
No, I'm in St. Louis right now. We've owned a home here for many, many years, and so that has been our home base. But we do, you probably maybe have caught wind of some of this in our newsletters, but we do envision a move to North Carolina, which is where our new director and his wife live, kind of forming an administrative team there. And we really feel like in order to be effective in our roles, that we need to be based, you know, close to them. Especially in these initial stages, not real sure about the long term, but in the next several years anyway, we envision ourselves being based down there. So yeah, we're actually in transition as far as that's concerned as well.
Okay.
But
what city will that be?
Well, they live in Kannapolis, which is just north of Charlotte.
Okay. Yeah.
North Carolina.
I'm familiar. I've been there. I think.
So. And there's actually quite a few mission aviation training opportunities around that area as well. So may still keep my hand in that if, as the Lord leads.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
That's cool. That's cool. What are the big obstacles you guys are up against presently?
Well, as far as ACM International goes, probably COVID has kind of rocked our world quite a bit. Movement restrictions have probably been the biggest hurdle that we've had to figure out, and we still have to figure out. There people aren't where they're supposed to be because of COVID, and that includes us. Our transition out of Africa actually took quite a bit longer because I had to leave Africa kind of suddenly, and there was a ban on all travel and movement in Kenya at the time. And so we really didn't get completely moved out of our house, and really didn't get to say proper goodbyes until just this last month. I would say just figuring out what the new normal is going to look like, what air travel is going to look like. Missionaries move a lot and need to be where they need to be, and you know, with all the movement restrictions, it's been a challenge over this last year.
Yeah, most of the places you work with have fairly good internet access, I suppose. They do. Yeah,
and to be honest, COVID-19 has presented as many opportunities as it has challenges, and one of the things that's happened. It's interesting, God's timing is always perfect, but the team in North Africa had been developing this online discipleship program. Probably 6 or 8 months they started the development of it before COVID hit, and it was actually due to roll out in March of this year, which is exactly when it hit. And so there were a lot of people stuck at home with lots of time to be on the internet. And they've just really had some pretty cool fruit from their efforts in that disciple-making, discipleship program. And even long distance, even though people aren't where they're supposed to be right now necessarily, they're still able to do all of that.
Yeah.
They're doing online trainings. So yeah, it's been interesting to watch God can always take something that's difficult and hard and turn it into something good to build his kingdom. And he's certainly doing that again.
Same story with us. Our online presence was a big zero until this, and we've learned some things and actually increased our virtual congregation by lots of people. And so there are people that tune into these from out of state and stuff. So it's pretty cool the reach that you can have with something like this.
That's true.
And I guessed that all the places where you have interaction would have good internet. I was in Myanmar early on a teaching trip in January. And I think the thing that surprised me most was the fact that everybody had a smartphone and was tied into the world in an unbelievably complete way. I mean, very savvy, and I would never have guessed that, but everybody's got a cell phone today.
It's true. I won't say internet's great everywhere that we work, but it functions and we can communicate. So,
right.
Yeah, there's other obstacles, but that's probably the most current one.
Yeah. Have all your friends stayed safe through it, or have you had any infections?
Well, we actually did. I don't know if you know the name Ed Nichols. He was in a care home, and he did pass away. They're saying that COVID was certainly a contributing factor, but we did lose him. As far as missionaries that are out on the field, no, there haven't been any infections even, so that's pretty amazing.
I have my first COVID funeral tomorrow, which will be yesterday by the time people see this, but sad situation, but stuff happens, man. If you got time, can you tell more what's happening in each of the fields? How many, I was on your website for a little bit, how many different people are you directly tied into?
So there are five different fields that we're currently in. Now we have influence in quite a number just from our history. And that we visit from time to time, especially some of our current missionaries that have relationships that they've built and churches that they've planted in different places, they'll go and visit those places. But active right now, we have our East Africa team that's based in Kenya. And there's actually going to be three couples working there, another COVID story. Right now, even the couple that's been based there is back in the States going on a tour. Their daughter is getting ready to move into her college years, and they're looking at some different colleges, but they hope to be back before Christmas. And then there's two other families that will join them. And their main focus is working with young men and soon to be women. One of the couples is going to focus more on the women that live on the streets. Right now, the ministry is focused in Nairobi, Kenya. And I think there's like 300,000 street kids in Nairobi. And just working with them, those that respond to the gospel, they work in kind of intentional discipleship programs with them at different levels. And the goal is that those that come through the discipleship program will become disciple makers themselves. And actually the ministry is led by a young man who is a former street kid himself. Working with them, and like I said, they'll be opening up a ministry to women as well, which is a whole different ballgame. We probably have no idea what we're getting ourselves into there. But huge need there in West Africa. It's relatively new to ACM. The couple that's there were former ACM missionaries that have just come back underneath our umbrella. But they work in disciple making and church planning as well. They also have a business development side, working with small businesses, trying to just help people be able to make a living. And then one of the most recent focuses is with youth that are school age in an area that's primarily Muslim, and just working with kids in kind of an after school program or library. I have a reading library for them to come to, and just again, the whole goal is to make disciples and make disciple makers that will spread the gospel. And then North Africa, again, disciple making, church planting is the goal there. The soil is pretty hard where we are, and it's slow going, although again, that's where this internet discipleship program has just kind of taken off. The soil does seem to be getting softer, so to speak, and ready for the seeds of the gospel to be planted. And so any minute, we keep saying this, but any minute we expect things to just really start exploding. And I did overhear a conversation just recently that there is fruit, and I don't have numbers or anything like that, but it is moving forward. And of course, the only way that our people can be in that country is through businesses, through real businesses that really make money, because the government watches that. They know missionaries sneak in under the umbrella of doing business but aren't really doing it. So they actually watch the books and make sure they're legitimate businesses. And even those businesses are aimed towards transformation and just bringing Christian principles into the society and into the culture that are radically different from what is there. The business that I'm most familiar with is accessible tourism, and people who are handicapped are kind of looked down on in North Africa, that they must have done something wrong, and this is God's curse. They're just kind of flipping that upside down. And our team there does consultation for tourists that come in, and they look for hotels that are accessible and transportation systems that are accessible, and what tours they could actually do. They even developed a saddle that works on a camel for people that wouldn't be able to do that kind of a thing. Even those businesses are designed to be transformative.
Which North African countries?
Well, I'm not really supposed to say the exact countries. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I get it.
I can tell you what we're doing there, or I can tell you where we are, but I can't tell you both, I think is the way it goes. I like
that. No, that area of the world, church historical interests to
agree. Oh, okay.
And North Africa, I think people don't understand the role it played in Christianity, that it was like the center of Christianity, and intellectual center of Christianity anyway. So it's a fascinating world, and fascinating to think how Christianity kind of got pushed out, but good to hear that it gets what used to be there.
Yeah. So yeah, the Lord keeps showing us different open doors, and it's just amazing to watch him work. It's also pretty intense spiritual warfare as well. It's very, very obvious that the enemy doesn't want us there, and our team has experienced several what we consider pretty major attacks. So you can be keeping them in your prayers.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I won't ask for details, because you'd have to kill me then, wouldn't you?
Now, maybe if we were one-on-one, although I'd rather them tell you than me tell you.
I can guess pretty much from what
you probably could.
So
absolutely. Yep.
Yeah.
And then there's also a couple that was in Southeast Asia for many years, and also North Africa, another Northwest African country. And they're actually living in North Carolina now and working with Muslims that are in the States, in school, Have relationships with several university students, and then business people. The lady teaches English as a second language, and she does English teaching for them. So they're still active. They're semi-retired. He has a part-time job, but they're still very active in ministry. And then also have a couple in the Philippines, mostly working to support the church that's very well established there, the indigenous church, and helping them branch out into new areas that are unreached. And they have a radio program, and they work in aviation as well. He's not an active pilot right now, but he is helping out the aviation program, which is how they're getting into these areas that are still pretty much unreached. Yeah. So those are the five main ministries we're involved in right now.
A lot of tension, the religious tensions in the Philippines too, aren't there? I think
yes.
People realize that that's a risky place in a lot of places for Christians to be also. So
yeah, there's some good stories there too. So.
Yeah. Again, I don't want you to have to kill me. So
no, that's not a closed country. So.
Yeah. Let's wrap up just some personal things. You've been, sure. How many years have you been flying and doing mission related work?
40 actually, just turned the clock at 40. We actually joined ACM, Cheryl and I did, before we were married, like weeks before we were married. We'd been affiliated with ACM because I grew up with ACM, but we didn't officially join until August of 1980, and then we were married in October of 1980, so just turned 40 years.
Yeah, obviously.
And like I said, I grew up over there. Mom and Dad were right. Missionaries in the Congo, so it goes back even farther than that for me.
Yeah, obviously you have found it a blessing to be in that kind of work, or else you would have left it a long time ago. What's the greatest blessing of doing what you do?
Probably in a word, relationships. What's amazing is my own personal relationship with the Lord has kind of grown by leaps and bounds and continues to. This last year, we've been in this transition. We actually gave Samaritan's Purse a year notice. And so I've been kind of transitioning out of different roles and handing over to other people. And sort of went through a little bit of an identity crisis because a lot of my roles were no longer my roles. They were somebody else's. and that kind of just made me go back to the foundational relationship that I have with the Lord. And it has become new and alive again, even over this past year, even after 40 years. You'd think I'd get that straight a long time ago, but
no, I get it.
It just keeps growing. And then that in turn affects relationships with others. And probably, the thing we're most excited about, it's been a bit more task oriented, our ministry, in especially in Samaritan's Purse. There's just a lot of things that needed to be done, a lot of go. But we're really kind of looking forward to kind of stepping back and slowing the pace down a bit, which, by the way, I think is a big part of what the Lord's trying to do with Corona in general, is just to slow our pace down and remind us of why we're here and that we're created to have a relationship with Him. And, I'm looking forward to just slowing down a bit and having more time for people and just being able to pour into the lives of other people. And the thing that we enjoyed by far the most in Samaritan's Purse was just being able to yeah, build into other people's lives some of the experiences that we've had in the past. This last month, I was able to turn over the flying that I was doing to a young man that I've been working with for like 2 years. He's now a captain on one of the airplanes that we fly over there, and I got to see him fly off by himself and, you know, do the work that I've been doing. And so just yeah, being able to invest in people and see the Lord bless that has been pretty cool.
You've said a couple of things that resonate with me. The whole slowing down, I think COVID teaches you to, you don't see as many people, but it teaches you to be aware of the people that are right in front of you. Yeah. And as I am entering the fall, at least, and no, it's the winter of my ministry, I'm very aware of that. But as I go into the winter, the thing that gives me the greatest joy is to see other people that I can mentor and move to a next step. And that's more fulfilling than anything that happens to me. So,
yeah.
So cool stuff.
That's where Cheryl and I are at, for sure.
Yeah. I appreciate you spending time with us. I just looked at how my picture looks, and there's sun coming in. I look sort of like a Friday the 13th horror picture or something. So that was not my intention. So.
Oh, it looks fine. It's fine. I probably have the same thing. There's usually this light good. Right over my head. Looks like I have a halo. But
you do. I thought you did.
No, that's just my hair is gone. So,
well, it's been fun talking to you. And I'll send you a link to our worship service, because at the end of our time here, we'll have a prayer for you at the end that will be a responsive prayer that people will do at home. So,
oh, cool. I just
want you to know that you guys are in our prayers. We don't get to see you in the flesh this time, but in pixels will work for today. And right. We'll hope that we get together with you soon. And being in the States around, you know, year round will give us more opportunities probably to do that. So as you start, as you do little swings around the country, just let us know what's happening.
Right.
We'll bring you in. Tell Cheryl hi from New Hope and the rest of your family, and you're in our prayers.
Thanks so much, John. Appreciate it.
Have a good rest of 2020.
All right.
All right. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye. And now I think it would be appropriate if New Hope and friends joined me in praying for Tim and Cheryl with a responsive prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for those who proclaim good news. We pray especially for those who share the gospel across cultures and over language barriers. Today, we especially thank you for Tim and Cheryl Doggett and the work of ACM International. Bless their important mission. In this period of transition, we pray that you would serve as their guide. Help them to leave behind whatever needs to be left behind and to embrace fully what you have in store for them. Fill them with the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Bless Tim and Cheryl as they mentor young missionaries and church leaders. Give them wise words, soft hearts, and a spirit of encouragement. Protect their own hearts and minds from evil. Let them rest safely in you, Lord. Protect their bodies from injury and disease. During the uncertainty of COVID-19, keep them safe from the virus and protect all their ministries as well. And most of all, may the witness of all they do and say bring glory to you. We pray this to you, our Father, in the name of the Son and by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Got any rivers you think are uncrossable? Got any mountains you can't tunnel through? God specializes in things thought impossible. He does the things others cannot do.
One of my favorite passages of Scripture, and I think I would go so far as to say it is one of the most important passages of Scripture for understanding the overall trajectory of the Bible, is the call of Abraham at the beginning of chapter 12 of Genesis. The Lord said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." It's that last part of it that we sometimes miss, the fact that God's intentions from the very beginning have been that all peoples of the earth, all people groups, would be blessed through Israel and then through the church. We don't exist for ourselves. As our missionary friends will tell us, we exist for the world. And our job is to bring people together, all peoples of the earth, and to bring them together around a table. That's what I think is so significant about missions and the Lord's table, that those two are connected. Paul says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Lord, we thank you for your body given on our behalf, and how we as a people have now been made into that body. We are your presence on this earth, and we pray that you would bless this bread to nourish us, to strengthen us to that mission, we pray. Through Christ our Lord, amen. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Hello, boys and girls. This is Miss Chris, and I'm going to read The Christmas Story. Long, long ago, a carpenter named Joseph and his wife, Mary, lived in the city of Nazareth. They had a small house, and they had a donkey, but they did not have any children. One day, an angel appeared before Mary. It was the angel Gabriel. "God has chosen you to be the mother of his son Jesus," the angel told Mary. That made Mary very happy. Not long after, Joseph and Mary had to travel to Bethlehem to pay their taxes. "It's a long journey," said Joseph. but you can ride our donkey. And so they went. When Mary and Joseph came to Bethlehem, it was late at night, and they were very, very tired. There was no room for them at the inn, but the innkeeper said that they could sleep in the stable. So they went there to rest for the night. In the stable were a cow, a lamb, a goat, and a dove. The animals were very friendly. They let Mary use their hay for a bed. That very night, the baby was born. Mary wrapped him up to keep him warm. There was no crib for the baby, so Mary laid him in the animal's manger. In the fields nearby, the shepherds who were watching their sheep saw an angel appear in the sky. The angel said to them, "I bring you news of great joy. Tonight in Bethlehem, a baby has been born in a stable. He is called Jesus Christ, and he is our Lord." The shepherds went to the stable, and when they saw the little baby in the manger, they were filled with joy. The shepherds knelt before little Jesus. They went out to tell people what the angel had said about the newborn baby. Far away in the east lived three wise men. They saw a new star in the sky. The three wise men knew the star was a sign that their Lord Jesus had been born. So the wise men set out to follow the star. The star had led them all the way to Bethlehem. It came to rest right above a little stable. The three men went inside the stable. They saw Joseph and Mary with the newborn baby. They knelt down before the baby Jesus and gave him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. Everyone was filled with joy. Even the animals in the stable seemed to know how special the baby was. Now, every year at Christmas, we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ because he brought the good news of God's love to the world. The end.